don't know how to make video. Hi everybody, my name is Joey, and every once in a while I make aquarium related videos right here on YouTube. Today we're in for a treat because we're gonna do another one. I'm sorry, it's finally summer.
Oh, it is so nice out. You can't even see me. Look out, look at this pale little Canadian out. I'm burning. I gotta get in.
Totally kidding. You guys know I got kids outside of here and, you know, summertime's here and they want to do activities. Apparently, I have to be involved in that to some extent. Today, we are going to be talking about the planted aquarium and how I set it up and forgot about it to an extent. Let me show you where it's at. Okay, I got this off right here because we're going to take a look at the equipment and I'll show you how I did everything, but have a peek here. Let me just adjust a few things here. It's not looking the best because we're at its awkward stage where the plants are starting to grow. Check it out, it's starting to spread everywhere. Nice root growth. You guys will remember we planted a 120-gallon aquarium with dwarf hair grass. The overall goal here is to create a nice lush green carpet and add in, I don't know, 100 or 200 tetras or maybe the same amount in shrimp, or we do both. And of course, I know what you're thinking. This is taking forever. It doesn't look that great, etc. I know. We're 4 weeks into a process that's probably going to take about 3 months. That's basically what it took me to do before, but we had some minor complications. Remember when we unboxed all those plants or essentially got them ready to put in the tank? I had mentioned that I was worried about how long that they weren't in water for. I had them in a fridge. Anyways, a lot of them started to smell sour, and when I put them in a couple of days later, they all started to turn white, but then we started to get some growth. Of course, if you follow me on Instagram, I've been kind of doing some little updates here and there. So I got a little bit let down. I was like, I don't really want to invest a lot into this tank. I'm going to find a bunch of scraps or recycled equipment that I already have that I could just toss on this tank and see what happens. I already had the filter. We went out and grabbed that at the local fish store months ago or whenever that was. We also know that we had this 5-pound CO2 tank with a regulator and bubble counters. It's old. I thought it was destroyed, but we got it working and it's working just fine. Canister filter is just set up with sponges right now. There's no fish in here, so I'm not really interested in cycling it. But when we do add fish, we're going to take previously established and fully cycled media from other aquariums and add it to this. Okay, so I clearly have to clean up, make it prettier in here. No big deal. Everything's on a timer right now. Let's start back there. So everything's just plugged into a timer, and not everything, but the CO2. As well as the lights. So everything comes on at once for about 7 to 8 hours a day. The bubble counter, here's the important part when it comes to CO2. You need a regulator. Even though mine's like rusted and water damaged and you name it, the main purpose of this is it has a solenoid valve or a solenoid valve or a solenoid, I don't know how you want to pronounce it, but you know what I'm trying to say. Basically, when power goes to this solenoid, it'll open. When the power shuts off, it closes, allowing CO2 to start and stop. Then we have a bubble counter, which in my opinion is entirely unnecessary unless you want to go by that rule of thumb of how many bubbles per second, whatever the case might be, and then a tiny little metal check valve so when the CO2 does turn off, water doesn't go back in to the bubble counter or, you know, drain the entire tank, because that's entirely possible. So we're injecting CO2 because we all know that plants take up CO2 and create oxygen. We learned this in preschool when, you know, that's what trees do sort of thing, but aquarium plants do the same thing, and then when you inject CO2 in an aquarium, they tend to grow a lot better, and for people like me who kills all plants, CO2 is like my secret weapon. I don't need to have crazy amounts of lights or awesome lighting, although it helps to have some great lights. CO2 is almost like my guarantee things are gonna work out. Oh, I'm so sweaty. I feel like I was just watching an episode of Cops. So we gotta ask ourselves, how much CO2 do we actually have to add to the aquarium? How do we regulate it? Some people go, a bubble a second per 10 gallon. I don't pay attention to any of that. The next thing that you want to use is a drop checker. That thing right there. It's flooded and it's not working properly. It's dirt cheap. It's old. But basically, you add a reagent to it, or a reagent, or a reactant. It's a liquid that will change color depending on how much CO2 is in the aquarium. It's a bell checker or a bell dropper. I don't know. I call it a drop checker. You put the liquid in there. You turn it upside down and it measures the CO2 in the tank. If it turns yellow, you don't have enough. If it turns blue, you have too much. If it's green, just right. Very amateur way to go about it, but it works really well for me. The next thing is on a 120-gallon aquarium, how am I going to inject all of this CO2 and make sure it's distributed amongst the aquarium? Well, planted tanks do need flow within the aquarium, not just from the output. A lot of the times in a big tank is simply not enough. I get way better growth when I add a wave maker or a power head to a planted tank. So all I did was I took a very cheap, very used, from 2 or 3 years ago, glass diffuser. You can see the bubbles going up through there. And then it has like a ceramic top to it where the bubbles can be pushed through it at a very small amount. I put it under the wave maker, it blows it throughout the aquarium. The most efficient I've found is to do an inline diffuser or maybe even a reactor, but this is pretty much the same thing. I'm gonna get the same size bubbles and they're gonna blow around the tank. It's annoying, but this is working really well. Oh, I wish this was more complicated, but that was basically it. We got the planted tank substrate, we put the plants in, got the CO2 going. I spent, you know, a day or two trying to get the CO2 dialed in properly, and then I left it. I literally didn't touch it. Then I had to go on a trip, I was gone away, I came back, and my tank, this whole tank was a nice little algae farm. It let me know that, Joey, you might not be able to grow plants, but you can certainly grow some algae. So the only maintenance I've done on this tank is a water change. I haven't even been filling this tank back up all the way. I mean, I'm just letting it go. And within a few more weeks, it's probably gonna be pretty lush. But the only thing that I did do was clean up the algae. However, I didn't really want to. When the algae bloomed, something crazy happened. First and foremost, all of the wood was covered in an algae. I thought that looked absolutely amazing. I thought it looked incredibly natural. The tank was so green looking. But of course, that's not really the overall aesthetic that we're looking for. So I took a little toothbrush and I brushed off as much algae as I could, but I didn't want to remove it completely because I'd rather it grow in and fill in the crevices and look pretty natural. And over time, I think it would look pretty incredible. But I don't want the algae to use up all the nutrients, so that's really the only reason I'm taking care of it. Then I did a big water change, filled it back up, came out the next day, and my tank was a bowl of green soup. It was really bad. I took off all that algae and a lot of it got trapped in the grass itself. Like here's some right here. It's like dying inside of the grass. The grass is fine. But a lot of that algae just kind of floated down. I removed as much as I could, but ultimately, as it dies, it's gonna be dislodged, taken up by the filter. Anyways, a lot of new nutrients pretty much added to the tank, causing this massive algae outbreak. And the worst part is I was actually gonna make a video the next day. So I was cleaning the tank. I was like, yeah, it'll look great for the video. And then I come out and it's a green soup. And I'm like, well, we're not making a video now. But I still gotta tell the story. I panicked and I tossed in some algae clean out from Fritz. I'm not one for adding anything like this. I think like things like this are a band-aid that fixes a temporary issue. The algae outbreak in this case was obviously an influx of nutrients. But when I added this in, a couple capfuls, I think, shut the lights off, came out the next day, it was back to being crystal clear, which I thought was pretty incredible because algae cleaners typically never work for me. But in this case scenario, since it was just an influx of nutrients, I knew that this wasn't necessarily going to be a band-aid. It was actually gonna fix the temporary issue and we could move on. But if you do have algae issues, a lot of times it's too much lighting, too much nutrients, not enough water changes, etc. I think I'm bubbling about 3 bubbles per second. The lights are on between 6 and 8 hours a day. And that's it, I haven't been doing anything else and everything's back on track, everything is looking good. I do notice one thing and one problem that we might have to address. You'll notice that in the center, the grass is growing a little thicker and we'll come back to this in a second, but on the outside, where the light is not getting to because of the logs are kind of blocking it. It's not growing in as quickly, but we are getting lots of roots everywhere. So I think over time it'll be fine. Now I know the plants, for example, in this area here, they're actually not that, they're very green in person. So I don't know, the white balance of the camera is kind of throwing this off, but it looks like just fluffs of grass. This is gonna be very dense, very thick. And when I start to trim it, it's gonna grow up pretty much straight. It looks phenomenal. It looks like a really nice lawn to your house.
And being a dad, I'm supposed to be into nice lawn, so this has been pretty exciting. At times, I'll stand back with my hands on my hips and just admire that grass, how well it's doing. So 1 month in and everything's doing well. I don't think I'm gonna change anything. I think I'm just going to let everything run automated. I'm not adding in any supplements. The only thing, like I said, was this algae cleanout, which worked really well. I'll just pay attention to the CO2 injection, make sure that stays steady, make sure the timer's still, I really don't have to do anything. This is done. This tank is done, in my opinion. There's no more I need to do with it. Obviously, I gotta clean up the filtration. Fill the tank up all the way, make things look a little prettier, but of course, within 2 months, this should be a carpet of lush green grass, in which at that time, I would like to add in the fish. I'd love to add them now, but just in case there's more problems or anything, I want this to grow in lush. We did this before, I think 3 years ago, where we waited until it was just a lush green carpet, and then we got the shrimp and we got some fish as well. But there you have it. This planted tank has been really simple, really easy. I'm really glad that I just took some random supplies and made it all work. And I think in the long term, I think it's gonna turn out great. I mean, it's difficult for me to show this part of the process because I know a lot of people be like, oh, that looks horrible, that looks bad. And by the end of the process, everybody's like, oh, that looks fantastic. But if you want to be able to stick around to be able to be the final judge, you're not subscribed to this channel yet, make sure you do because I make videos. Sometimes. I'm trying. It's hot out. I love it. Goodbye.